It's about that time. Come on in and have a seat, and we'll get started. Glad to see all of you guys. We were out last week, and I know y'all didn't miss me, but I heard it was a gigantic Midnight Madness. 40 kids, is that right? Where's Jeremy at? I don't see him. I think it was like 40 kids, so I'm really glad I wasn't here. It's too many. No, it's really good. Anyway, now that I've told y'all to have a seat, let's all stand together and we'll sing.
Shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah unto the Lord. Shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah unto the Lord. Sing aloud to God, let the people shout before his throne. Hallelujah, sing aloud to God, make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah unto the Lord. Shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah unto the Lord. From the ends of the earth, from the depths of the sea, let all creation praise his name. From the ends of the earth, from the depths of the sea, let all creation praise his name. Shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah unto the Lord. Shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah unto the Lord. Shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah unto the Lord. The Lord reigns, he is a mighty God. The Lord God reigns, the Lord reigns, he is a mighty God. The Lord God reigns. Great is the Lord Almighty, he is Lord, he is God indeed. Great is the Lord Almighty, he is God supreme. Great is the Lord Almighty, he is God indeed. Great is the Lord. Great is the God reigns, the Lord reigns, he is mighty God, the Lord God reigns. Great is the Lord Almighty, he is Lord, he is God indeed. Great is the Lord Almighty, he is God supreme. Great is the Lord Almighty, he is Lord, he is God indeed. Great is the Lord. Great is the Lord.
Be seated.
Father, we thank you so much for the good night's rest. Thank you for this opportunity to be together this morning with our family. And we pray that we'll encourage one another and build up one another as we join our hearts together and voices together in song and prayer and worship to you today. Father, we pray that as we go to our workplaces tomorrow that we will let people know that you are our Father and that we love you and we love them. And we just pray that they would see the love in our lives for you and for your Son. We thank you for Jesus Christ and for the sacrifice that he made, that you made just for us. And we just thank you for the salvation and the mercy and the grace that's available to us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
As the deer thirsts for the water, Lord, yes, my soul longs after you. My soul thirsts for the living God. Yes, my soul longs after you. And I pour out my soul deep within me. Deep within me, I pour out my soul. Draw me deeper, Lord, deeper, Lord, in you. Draw me deeper, Lord, deeper, Lord, in you. As the deep thirsts for the water, Lord, so my soul longs after you. Thirst for the living God. Yes, my soul longs after you. And I pour out my soul deep within me. Deep within me, I pour out my soul. Draw me deeper, Lord, deeper, Lord, in you. Draw me deeper, Lord, deeper, Lord, in you. And I pour out my soul deep within me. Deep within me, I pour out my soul. Draw me deeper, Lord, deeper, Lord, in you. Draw me deeper, Lord, deeper, Lord, in you. Shield about me, you're my glory, you're the lifter of my head. Thou, Lord, art a shield about me, you're my glory, you're
come before the Lord today, celebrating the death, burial, and resurrection. And I just ask you to look around you at your brothers and sisters. You have a couple of new ones. Leah and Gabe were baptized recently, so this is their first communion after the baptism. And we celebrate with their new birth. We celebrate the Lord. Resurrection, too. Would you bow with me? Father, thank you for the opportunity to be with our brothers and sisters this morning to commune together and to remember the great sacrifice that you gave in sending your Son to live with us, to die, and to be resurrected, the power over death. Father, we take these symbols. First, we take the bread, which he teaches is the bread of life. It's the bread of his body, and it's the bread that is everlasting. Father, as we take of this, we want to remember the sacrifice that you gave through your Son. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you bow with me again? Father, we are deeply thankful for the symbol of his Christ's blood. It went out of his body to cleanse us. Father, we are humbled because you loved us so richly and so deeply that you would send your Son to be crucified knowingly, innocent, but crucified for us, for our sins. And as we remember that today, we're thankful that you give us the hope of eternal life and resurrection as you did your Son. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. as a tradition was established long ago to help those in different churches, today we participate in collection to take care of different needs, material needs, and help with families. Would you pray with me? Father, we're thankful for the opportunity to give back monetarily as we've purposed in our hearts, as we've planned, as we've committed to a budget to pay off necessities, to keep the lights on and all. We just pray that you bless us as we bless others throughout this giving. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. While we're finishing up that, I regret to announce that Norma Williams, this is the mother of Lisa Mays, passed away Friday evening in Jacksonville, Florida. She will be laid to rest this Thursday, which is the 12th, at Woodlawn Cemetery in Nashville. The family will return to Jacksonville for a memorial service to be held a week from tomorrow, which is the 16th of September. Please continue to pray and comfort this family. And if you want more information about some of these details, see Linda. Let's just go ahead and pray right now before we proceed. Father, thank you again for bringing us here today. This family. Father, just be with Lisa, Gary, and the entire family as they mourn this loss. And Father, just help us as their family to support them and find our way to help them in this time of need. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And just a few announcements here. Don't forget, Closet is coming up soon. Now accepting donations for fall and winter clothing. It'll be on October the 26th. And I know I've said this over and over, but the fall really is our biggest one. Man, we have tons and tons of people that show up to get clothes. And so if you can help out on October the 26th, please plan on doing that. It's just a few hours. It doesn't take up very much time of your day. And if you have any questions about what's going on, if you've never done it before, you can see Linda or Brian or Heather. I'm sure there's somebody else I'm leaving out. But anyway, please come and help if you can do that. Benches and tables for pavilions, we've reached our goal on those. So thank you for that. The plan is to use the pavilion for the fish fry coming up at the end of the month. So we'll put those to good use pretty soon. And as far as our youth goes, we have a youth devotional on the 22nd. That'll be in 2 weeks. And we'll have some more info about that coming up soon. In first through sixth grade, you guys can still do your books of the Bible for the 66 Club. We're going to have a party for that on September the 29th after lunch. And parents, you guys will get an email that has those details later this week. And if you aren't getting emails, please let us know. I'm not singing that. This is what happens when you, this is what we talked about this morning, Nikki. I know, I don't know why I do this job. I'm getting requests back there from the youth group. I'm never singing that song again, okay? But anyway, so pay no attention to the man behind the curtain back there. So if you're not getting emails, please let somebody know, youth emails, and we'll get you taken care of on that, and we'll get that handled. And then we've sort of made mention of it. But very exciting. Let me get Dean and Leah to come on up. Got a lovely Bible. These are hard to come. Did I say Dean? I don't know why I said that. Gabe, Why did I say Dean? I'm having a stroke. Gabe Rose and Leah Brown. I almost said Gabe and Rose. Bibles are hard to come by since they closed all the Christian bookstores these days. So here you go, Gabe, not Dean. His name is not Dean. Don't call him Dean. Hey, wait a minute. Gabe, come back up here. You got to stand up here and smile at everybody. Here you go, Leah. All right, now y'all give him a big hand. All right, you can go now. Yeah, thanks. All right, we'll take about 6 minutes right here. Oh, wait, Bron's got one, and then he'll tell you how long we're going to take.
Sorry, real quick, I was just reminded that next Sunday is the third Sunday of the month, which means it will be a closet work night here. If you can help us sort through stuff that's been donated, we will meet up here at 5 to do that next Sunday. So let's take 6 minutes and greet everybody. Thank you.
All right, we get everybody to get you a chair. And we are having children's church today. So if you go to children's church, you can head back that way at this time as well. Let's all stand up one more time before Nikki comes and speaks to us this morning.
To Canaan land I'm on my way, where the soul never dies. My darkest night will turn to day, where the soul never dies. No sad farewells, no tear-dimmed eyes, where all is love and the soul never dies. No roses blooming there for me, where the soul never dies. And I will spend eternity where the soul never dies. No sad farewells, no tear dimmed eyes, where all is love and the soul never dies. I'm on my way to that fair land where the soul never dies, where there will be no parting, and where the soul never dies. No sad farewells, no tear-dimmed eyes, where all is love and the soul never dies.
Be seated.
Okay, I am not like Ray. Look, that's my sermon, like four pages of. It's not going to take that long. But several visitors, I really appreciate you being here. This is not about me. This is we were talking about maybe somebody in this audience that still has a lot of doubts about the Bible or miracles or science, and just do miracles contradict science? And that's the lesson for today. Have you heard about the Jeffersonian Bible? I meant to give you a little picture of it. It's kind of neat. It's in the Smithsonian. And Thomas Jefferson was a deist. Well, do you know what a deist is? Raise your hand if you know what a deist is. Okay. A deist, you had the scientific revolution, and a lot of the scientists after that, 100 years later, started saying, well, there is no God. And so a lot of the believers in God and believers in the Bible tried to compromise and say, okay, well, let's don't just throw out the belief in God altogether. So they still believed in God, that God created everything. But then they said God did never intervene after that supernaturally, like to do miracles or anything, because that defies science. So that was their compromise. So it became known as deist. In other words, the illustration is he's got a clock and he got it running and started it and backed off. And then God never intervened, so the miracles in the Bible aren't true. Somebody just added those. Jesus wasn't raised from the dead. So Thomas Jefferson took six Bibles and cut and pasted the first illustration of the great cut and paste. He cut and pasted his own Bible, and it has no miracles in it. Pull it up and look at an image of it, of the Smithsonian. And it has nothing in there about the resurrection. So that brings up what we were talking about, because the Marty Sampson of Hillsong, who just said, I don't believe in God anymore, after 20 years of writing songs for Hillsong, praise. And he said, science keeps piercing the truth of religion. Well, see, the fatal assumption is that science has proved that miracles cannot happen. Okay? Well, that's just not true. Science can only prove what can be tested in a laboratory and reproduced in a laboratory. You can run experiments, drop apples, and get the acceleration of gravity, 9.8 meters per second squared. You can do all that and come up with a law that's going to work every single time, no exceptions. So science can only prove what they can prove in the laboratory. They can't prove that something did not happen in history. Now, they can say, well, yeah, this, whatever, a miracle would be totally contrary to the normal course of things, but they can't say it didn't happen. We would have to rely on the usual historical evidence to determine if something really happened. And you know what's interesting? When I talk about do miracles contradict, I'd rather use override. When you go into a system and it's set on a certain thing, a mechanical system, and you push override, you're going to change it just one time, and then it goes back to normal. My grades on Canvas, if I change a grade, you click in the new grade, and it has a little box that says overwrite the existing grades. So I click that. So that's kind of what I see it, is that God created the law of gravity, and it is a law that works, has worked from the beginning. And so God he steps in and overwrites that law and lets Jesus walk on water, lets Peter walk on water. Now, what's interesting is the early scientists, the scientific revolution for the 15th to 17th century, like Newton and the law of gravity and the three laws of motion that govern physics, all of physics, and I'll try to impress you, Copernicus and Galileo and Pascal and Boyle's. How would you like to have a law named after you, Boyle's law? Or a degree in the temperature scale, Kelvin, named after you? But see, those guys, when they were discovering these laws, everything I've read is, it made them just, wow, look at the laws that God has put in nature from the very beginning. And look what we figured out. And God's up there like, took y'all this long to figure that out? Seriously. And that they didn't, after they got through discovering the law of gravity and all these laws, and there's hundreds of them that govern nature and physics and then light and intensity of light and just you name it, air and air pressure and all that stuff. So they didn't, when they got through, say, okay, there must not be a God because we discovered all these laws. And we discovered the law of gravity, and normally you can't walk on water, so I guess nobody ever walked on water. They didn't say that. For example, Boyle's, of the Boyle's law and chemistry and physics, he said that the resurrection of Jesus is a fact. So it didn't destroy their faith in God, but that's not true today. Many of the scientists say, okay, you have the law of gravity, and nobody could have ever defied that and walked on water. So there's the problem that we're dealing with. Now, maybe it's important that we define a miracle, Mike. We always talk about that. What is a miracle? Because you'll say the miracle of birth. Listen, the miracle of birth, birth is a wondrous thing. And it's obviously within the working of God, But in biblical, and just semantics here, in biblical terms, a miracle, the birth is only a miracle of a child if it's like the case of Isaac and the mother's 90 and the father's 100. Okay? Now that's what we're just defining a Bible miracle. You can call a birth of a child a miracle. That's okay. I don't have a problem with that. But I'm talking about Bible miracles. And I hate to give a definition, but it's an event that cannot be explained solely by natural processes, but which requires direct causal agency by supernatural being. Obviously, I didn't make that up. I copied and pasted from somebody. But, It's only reasonable. Think about this. Romans chapter 1 is what we call natural revelation. Romans 1 says you can't see God, and yet you look at what he created. The very fact that it exists and cannot come from nothing, first law of thermo, and then it hasn't been here forever, second law, and it's designed, the periodic table, the 30 little intricate details that have to be fine-tuned to have life on earth. And so you look at that, and the Bible says, not me, that a fool says there is no God. So any reasonable, open-minded, honest, humble person will look at that and say, there had to be a creator, a designer, a God. Okay? And so if that's true, but that doesn't tell you what that God wants. At least the Egyptians and the Mesopotamians and the Babylonians and, you know, at least they were smart enough to say, well, there's got to be a God. So they started making up all these stories about the creation and their gods, and they made up gods. But at least they saw there had to be a God. They weren't atheists. And God tried to give them what we call special revelation. Special revelation is where God makes his will known to the people he created. Well, isn't it reasonable then, if there is a God, and he wanted to reveal to us his will, that he would come in and confirm it? What better way to do that than by taking the law of gravity and walking on water? Okay, Moses, great illustration. The story of Moses. And, well, God, how can I? They don't know who you are. They worship all these other gods. How can they know that you're really the one true God? He said, okay. You know, the staff, and then he did 10 plagues, turned a whole river into blood, darkened the sun, you know. And all those were to direct attacks at the gods of Egypt. He's trying to give special revelation. Pharaoh rejected it because he was hard-hearted. So it's reasonable that there would be miracles. And you got all kinds of miracles. The miracles of the Old Testament, the 40 years in the wilderness. Can you imagine millions and millions of gallons of water coming out of a rock? You've got the miracles of the prophets, Elijah, raising a dead child, Elisha, axe heads down at the bottom of the river. Here comes the axe head floating up on the river. Stick your stick in there and grab it. You've got the miracles of Jesus. John has 7 of them, specially selected, walking on water, water to wine, healing a man born blind, healing a man born lame, raising Lazarus, feeding the 5,000, and he says these miracles are to prove, to confirm to you that he is the Son of God. I'm going to step in, I'm going to overwrite the law of gravity, let him walk on water. I'm going to overwrite the law of fermentation and turn water to wine immediately, aged wine immediately. And by the way, people say, if things look old that God created, he's trying to deceive us. Was Jesus trying to deceive anybody? By doing that, of course not. And then you've got the miracles of the apostles. Well, what about this verse? On the day of Pentecost, when he was preaching, he said, hey, Jesus did, God confirmed to you that he was the Son of God with miracles and wonders and signs. The 3 Greek words used to describe miracles. Miracles, wonders, and signs. And they were performed in your midst. You always hear somebody, oh, they raised somebody from the dead in Africa. He said, no, these were done in your midst. Jesus was 50 days before this sermon, and then 3 years of miracles, I mean, all over the place, undeniable. They were done in your midst, and nobody objected. Nobody said, no, he was a fake, he was a fraud, he was a charlatan. And then you had the miracle of the apostles, of course, who he sent them out and confirmed the word with miracles and signs and wonders. But you know the greatest miracle. Because, again, we still talk about, where do we have the main testimony of the miracles? It's from the Gospels. Who wrote the Gospels? Well, supposedly his disciples, or Luke was a companion of Paul, who was an apostle, or Mark got his information, we think, a lot of it from Peter. And so these guys were biased. You know, if I had some false religion, and their followers said, oh, our prophet did miracles, I'd be pretty skeptical. So you can understand people being skeptical, can't you? I mean, the disciples who told us about all the miracles in the Gospels were his followers. And that's why the resurrection is the ultimate, chief, main proof of everything. Everything. Acts 17, great verse. He says he's appointed a day which he will judge the world, having furnished, talking about Jesus, having furnished proof to all men by raising him from the dead. The resurrection of Jesus is the ultimate main proof. I mean, if he was raised from the dead, you can believe that he, all the miracles he did were true, even though we might, you know, we just have biased disciples' testimony, but you can believe that. He affirmed everything in the Old Testament, so you can believe all these miracles in the Old Testament. How do I know that Jonah was really in the belly of a fish? Because Jesus said so. So the resurrection of Jesus is the ultimate proof. And that's what Paul said in 1 Corinthians 14. He said, guys, if there's no resurrection of the dead, if that defies science and it cannot happen, cannot ever have happened, then Jesus wasn't raised from the dead. And hey, we're false apostles. Your faith is totally in vain. We are really rather foolish, he says, because here we are denying ourselves for something that's not even true. And you're missing out on a whole lot of fun because you're trying to deny yourself for something that's not even true. And we're just going to die and that's it. No eternal life. And so he gives in 1 Corinthians 15, he gives the appearances of Jesus after the resurrection. And what's interesting, one of these verses, I'm going to come back to it, he even appeared to more than 500 brethren at one time. And Paul said, hey, most of them are still alive, and you can just go talk to them if you want to. How do we know if we walked on the moon? Is anybody in here that doesn't believe we walked on the moon? Okay. Have you ever met somebody that didn't believe we walked on the moon? Raise your hand. Isn't that something? I have too. And you think, are you serious? Well, how do you know anything really happened in history? I mean, you weren't there. You believe you walked on the moon. You weren't there. You saw it on TV. Well, they can do tricky stuff with TV, right? So how do you know we really walked on the moon? Credible, believable, eyewitness testimony. If we just take the resurrection and like we would any event, examine it from that standpoint, is there credible eyewitness testimony? And the answer is, of course, yes. The witnesses that we bring in there to examine them, did this really happen? The apostles? Well, they were biased, but were they credible? Yes. Motives, character. Were there a sufficient number? Yes. Maybe they were hallucinating. 500 people at one time don't hallucinate. Go talk to them. See, you know, see what they say. Wow. 50 days after the resurrection, they were preaching the resurrection in the same city that it supposedly occurred. Imagine if I got up and said, 50 days ago, there was a resurrection from the dead at Maple Hill Cemetery. You don't think the reporters would be all over that? Checking it out? Proving it wasn't true? Some people, even the swoon theory, famous back in my day in the 60s, and the swoon theory, maybe fake death. Yeah, right. These professional executioners declared him dead, didn't even break his legs because he was dead. He was scourged, crucified, put in a tomb for 3 days, and walked out and faked death. I don't believe so. Well, this is really important. The enemies admitted the tomb was empty. That's critical. Why else would they make up a story that the disciples stole the body? Just go find the body. And why didn't they arrest the apostles and say, we're going to start an investigation. We're going to find that body. Because they knew that the body was not in there, that it was missing. And so the tomb was empty. And here's what you'd have to believe. That we're in a court, and somebody comes in and said, no, it didn't happen. The disciples stole the body. Okay, so you had four soldiers. You've heard this before, haven't you? I've probably preached it if you've been here long enough. But you had four. You forgot it, though, didn't you? They forgot the sermon, so here we go. So probably four soldiers, and if they fall asleep and let that body be stolen, they die. And so somehow the disciples, who were too afraid, they did not expect Jesus to be raised, so they're hiding in their house, and all of a sudden they get the courage, hey, let's make up a story and go steal the body and say he was raised. So they tiptoe past four sleeping soldiers. They roll back a stone that weighed 2,000 pounds. One of the ancient manuscripts said it took many men to move that stone. So without making a noise, tiptoe, move the stone, get the body, tiptoe back out past the four and never wake up a single one of them. You believe that? Does that sound real logical? And then there's the conversion of Paul. Paul is killing Christians. Nobody had the courage to show him the jewel metal film strips and try to convert him. Most of you don't know what I'm talking about. I'll say that. But nobody had the courage to do that. The only thing to convert him was his on the road to go kill more Christians and put them in prison. And he saw the resurrected Jesus. And it changed him. And he became, why do people change? Money, get a cult following, sex, whatever. No. He became basically a martyr, got beheaded for preaching the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And then what about Jesus' brother, James? Did you know even when Jesus was doing the miracles, his own brother and his other brothers did not believe in him? It took the resurrection to convince them that he really did miracles and that he really was who he said he was. Now, last part of this lesson is this. All this that I've said hinges on whether, I got to practice this word, is it pseudonymous? In other words, all the critics say, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John didn't write the Gospels. Somebody wrote them in the second century. Those guys all died in the first century. And somebody wrote them pseudonymously. How's that? In other words, wrote those Gospels and claimed that Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John wrote them. That's what most of the critics say. Well, so much of this hinges on the Gospels really being written by Matthew, Mark, and John and being written, obviously, early. Why is that so? Well, Luke chapter 2, Luke chapter 1, I did that. Luke chapter 1 starts off, because Luke's different. You know, Luke's different from the other Gospels. He's Paul's companion, a doctor. He's writing to Theophilus, some Roman official, apparently. He wants to tell him all the, Theophilus is interested. But he didn't want to go on legends and fables and myths. He said, I'm going back and investigate all the stories. And you know who I'm going to talk to? The eyewitnesses. That's critical. The eyewitnesses had to be alive. He could talk to them. Do you remember the story of the Scottsboro Nine? Raise your hand if you remember the Scottsboro Nine. Sad, tragic story. Nine guys were accused of raping. Nine black guys were accused of raping two white girls. They did not do it. Long story. But 50 years after the fact, somebody did some investigative reporting. It was critical they could go talk to the judge in Athens, the witnesses, the guy that was supposed to do a test in Scottsboro to see if they were actually, it was critical. If you wait 100 years after that, you can't do that. So if the gospel was written early like they claim, then people could go investigate it. They could talk to the witnesses. And that's what happened, and it stood the test of time. It stood the test of time. Now, this is where my favorite subject, the destruction of Jerusalem in the year 70 AD. I had to say that clearly because I kept saying AD 70. One of my kids, I finally realized he thought I was saying 1870. AD, Anno Domini, is that it? 70, 2,000 years ago, almost. We're in 2019 AD, AD 2019. So, did you know that? Here's the logic. Now listen to this. I've heard all kind of, and we don't have the manuscripts. I wish we had a copy of Luke that we could know for sure was written in 60 AD, which is about when I think it was written, but we don't. How do I know that they were written early by really Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, like they say? Here's my main proof. All four Gospels, especially Matthew, Mark, and Luke, they all predict. Now, Matthew, he'll the birth of Jesus, they go search in Matthew 2, in Malachi, where did it say he's going to be born? Bethlehem, boom, Matthew says it was fulfilled. Here's another prophecy from the Old Testament. Matthew says it was fulfilled. Jesus said Peter would deny him 3 times. And then Matthew shows you later it was fulfilled. There's a prophecy that he doesn't say that about. And that's the great Olivet Discourse and many other places, but mainly Matthew 24, Luke 13, or Luke 21, Mark 13. And Jesus predicts that within that generation, the Romans will come in and destroy the temple and the city of Jerusalem, the great abomination of desolation as predicted by Daniel. Guess what? Does Matthew say, and that was fulfilled. If those books were written after that, they would have said so as a great proof that Jesus was a prophet. Let me give you an illustration. If we found an old book, and it was about the persecution of the Jews, and it told about, because they've been persecuted all for the last 2,000 years, you know. But it got right up to and included persecutions right up to the Holocaust and stopped and did not include the Holocaust. When would you think the book was written? Before the Holocaust or after the Holocaust? Yeah. You'd say, well, it had to be written before the Holocaust. Surely he would have included this great killing of 5 million, 6 million Jews. Same logic. I've heard several guys use this in evidences. I just think it's the ultimate proof. And yet it's also like all the Gospels and the New Testament letters, most of them, end up being written, collected, copied, circulated, and this prediction is right there waiting to come true. And if it doesn't come true, throw that New Testament away. Jesus and the apostles were false prophets. Forget the whole thing. If it comes true, a great witness to the fact that Jesus was a true prophet and the apostles were true prophets. And the Bible's the Word of God. One last thing. What about all these Old Testament messianic prophecies? Isaiah 53, which includes several predictions. How he's going to be buried in a rich man's tomb, or at least that's the basis of that. And then between the two thieves, silent suffering, pierced, scourged. How do we know that those things weren't added after the fact? That's exactly what the liberals say. Somebody came in and, you know, that's what they say about the miracles of Jesus. They say, oh, the original gospel was some document called Q, that we don't have, and it has no miracles in it, kind of like Thomas Jefferson's Bible. And then the believers of Jesus, the disciples, in the late first century, second century, they just added those things. How do we know that Isaiah 53 really read like it does? The Dead Sea Scrolls. We don't have time to start talking about them. The earliest copy we had of the Hebrew Isaiah was 1,000 A.D., 1,000 years after the birth of Jesus. When they found the Dead Sea Scrolls in the Qumran Hills, 1947, they found the great Isaiah scroll. This thing rolled out, this scroll. I can't remember how many feet it was. And they looked at Isaiah 53. Every dating method said that was dated at least 100 years before Jesus was born. No question about the dating of it. And then you think, well, okay, how did that Isaiah 53 and that compare to the copy we have 1,200 years later? Guess what? Almost identical. Very few minute changes that didn't matter. Every prediction about the death of Jesus read exactly like it does, and they were written not after the fact, but at least 100 years before. We've got all kind of proof, guys. that the Bible's the Word of God, that miracles did happen. Now, close with this thought. I love that verse, 1 Thessalonians 2. He said to the Thessalonians, when you receive the Word of God, which you've heard from us, you accept it not as the Word of man, but for what it really is, the Word of God. I hear so many people saying the Bible's just the Word of man, full of errors, false expectations. Science cannot prove miracles did not. We have plenty of historical proof they did. Now, what are you going to do with that? Okay, nice intellectual sermon. Now, the real question is, what are you going to do with it? Because Paul said, if you believe in your heart that Jesus was raised from the dead, that verse doesn't include everything. We need to repent. You got baptism. But this is the core right here, that you believe in your heart that Jesus was raised from the dead. So is there someone in this audience, you've had your doubts, but you know, hey, now that helps me, then I'm glad. That helps me believe that he was raised from the dead. That just kind of ties it all together. And to know the Bible is not what men say it is. A bunch of books written pseudonymously, whatever. That helps my faith. Hope it helps your faith. And for somebody that ready to confess Jesus as Lord, repent and be baptized, then we're here to help you, either up here, talk back later, whatever. Please come if you feel that need to.
So I'll say, I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies. I know the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. I know the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of salvation be exalted. Who's our God except the Lord? Who's our rock except our God? He's a shield for all who will rest in him. I know the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock. Let the God of my salvation be exalted. I know the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock. And let the God of my salvation be exalted. Jesus Christ, he died for me, and he took away my sin. I will live with him for eternity. I know the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. I know the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. I will call upon the Lord.
Oh, Father, we have every reason to celebrate thanks to you this morning and every day. Father, you've given us the one key thing that we all need, no matter how long we live. We could be here a million years, Father, and we could never accomplish what you did for us through our Savior, through your Son. And so we celebrate this morning because of that. Even if we come with heavy hearts or if we're full of joy, we celebrate because of that gift, Father. But Father, I thank you for what Nikki has had the courage and the wisdom and the understanding to share with us, because I know there are people struggling with this. Some may not, Father, but I know there are many that are. And I pray that we can be patient and loving and kind and understanding with them, and to provide just the answers that we can provide, Father. I know you've called us to trust, and you've not called us to a blind trust. And we thank you for that. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your spirit. We thank you for the knowledge that people like Nikki and many others have and able to explain that. But ultimately, God, I pray you help us to trust as our Savior trusted on that day that he gave his life. Father, he trusted in your plan. He trusted that you could accomplish what you said you would. Help us to have that trust. We love you, Father. In Jesus' name.